What you got there, buddy?
Oh, hey folks. Well, we are just about ready to start cutting some bearing blocks here. So we've got our rough layout down in the fish hold. That's more or less the height that they're gonna be, but the position is important. So I got a bunch of chicken scratch on my sheet of paper here. We're gonna cut these about 7 inches high. It's gonna be a stack of three on end. Then we'll put a half inch layer of solid glass over the top for the bearing to sit on. Right now we are going with the Babbitt bearings that were in the boat originally, but we are making accommodations to convert it to a split roller bearing later. So this housing is a little bit deeper, so we have to make sure that we keep these about an inch down. The split bearings are, they will fit in there, so that's nice. Really the only difference between them is the depth of it from center line to the bottom. It is about an inch longer than the Babbitt bearing, so that's not a problem. We just make the bearing blocks that the bearings sit on a little bit shorter. We'll just put a big heavy thick shim in there, and then the bolt pattern, it's a little bit wider, the bolt pattern, but that's something that we can easily re-drill and bed in some bolts for that. So these come in both 4-bolt and 2-bolt. We'll just go with the 2-bolt. That's standard for this. Not much else to say. There's just enough clearance between the forward one and the bottom of the shaft alley cover, so that's nice. It's really close, but there's enough clearance there. I'm not sure if we'll switch these right away or not. They're pretty expensive, so we're kind of debating it. I did find some on eBay, but they're about $900 each, which is kind of spendy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that we're just gonna have to kind of play by ear. Nothing wrong with the Babbitt bearings. They've done perfectly well, so I think it might be the type of thing that we just, well, it's kind of a tough call because it's kind of like the way these split bearings work is that there's a sleeve in there that clamps on the shaft. So if you get any wear on your shaft, then it's kind of hard to retrofit it. So it might be the type of thing that we just watch this really close. These are actually easy just to pop the cap off and look down there and you can see the condition of the bearing. You can see the condition of the shaft. So I'm not sure exactly what we're gonna do. We're keeping an open mind. Anyways, so we're just gonna cut these a little over 7 inches. We'll laminate them all together, put it on end, and that'll be our bearing block. This doesn't need to be perfect by any means, because we will laminate these together and then we'll trim them. One side, there's actually about a 1/4 inch slope on the shaft alley right there, so we have to take that into account too. So we'll probably just trim it at a slight angle. Yeah. So I feel like we're making progress again.
Thinner, but more or less like that.
We have our first bearing block for the forward one. pretty simple design. This is the height we need. It's about an inch and a half lower than our existing bearings. Once again, we're designing this with the idea in mind that we may switch to split bearings later. Mm-hmm. And so if we do that now, we'll save ourselves a lot of work of trying to get in through an access hatch and trim this down, re-glass it, you know, clean up a huge mess.
Yeah,
it's just gonna bomb the whole thing. And so we're building it now with future plan in mind. We'll do the same thing. We'll build up a heavy plate, just like a 1-inch plate for a shim out of fiberglass. That way we don't have a bunch of different metals in here corroding against each other. And if we do upgrade it to a split bearing later, then we'll be set. So we've got the dimensions for that, so we're just taking all that into consideration. Just a simple arch right here. This will allow the water to flow through, but also allow it to flow through without splashing. If we just put it like the old one did, with the holes on the side, as water sloshes back and forth, it hits this and splashes up on the bearings. So that's our thought in mind by making this an arch like that.
Mm-hmm.
Structurally, there'll be a ton of strength in here. Three layers, quarter inch in between each one. You're gonna have essentially over an inch of build just this way of compressive fiberglass. And then of course you'll have a nice thick cap on the top. On the arches, everything will be tabbed in. It's gonna be bulletproof. There's not a whole lot of weight on this in reality. It's literally carrying half the weight of the shaft, which is about 300 pounds. Mm-hmm. So this is way overkill, but it'll be nice and simple. As far as fastening the new bearing block, it's a 2-bolt one. If we upgrade it, it'll also be a 2-bolt. So in the middle of these layers right here, we'll just go ahead and cut that out now. We'll leave a gap. And then we'll just bed a tube in there later. That can provide compressive strength for a bolt, so it'll resist crushing. And we should have a really nice, flat, rigid block when we're done.
Mm-hmm.
Where when we go to tighten down the bearings, you're not crushing this and distorting the material. That's what you want to avoid, is distortion there. Because you want this to be rigid enough that when you align your shaft, that it's going to stay aligned and it's not going to shift and move around because you've got flex in your part. So that's why we're building it rigid more than anything. It's not a strength-wise thing for carrying a heavy load, it's for rigidity. And this will provide that and more. So there we are. I'm going to cut this out. We get it cleaned up. We'll get these three pieces laminated together today, and then we'll get them trimmed out and fit down there. Other ones cut, and Matt's gonna get these laminated together, I guess, today.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And we'll start getting that fit in. It's pretty much ready to go. Matt got it laminated together yesterday. Went really heavy on the web inside. There'll be a bolt coming through on each side right here. for the bearing, such as this. So we'll make up a tube that goes through there. That same OD that'll fit between these webs, and then ID just a little bit bigger than our bolts. And that way when we tighten them down, it'll prevent any kind of crushing. Not that I think we'd see it anyways with the web this heavy, but we want this area to be nice and rigid for these. So once we get them indicated in and they're tightened down, they won't be shifting any. None of this foam will try and crush or anything. This stuff will crush, like, you know, the laminate's thick, but it'll still bend and it'll crush over time. So it's important to kind of take a few precautions like that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we went with a nice thick web on the inside. So next we just laminate the outside and put a top plate on there, and that's pretty much ready to go.
Yeah.
So this foam is really nice to work with. We'll start out here by radiusing these corners. Usually I just use a grinder to get the heavy off. I don't know if I will right here. Pretty easy to kind of lose control, curved and whatnot, but this stuff does sand down really quickly. So we're probably looking for about a half inch radius on this. So we'll just work that down. It won't take long. That'll allow that glass just to roll right around that corner real nice without trying to lift off, leave any voids or pockets or anything. So we'll get that cleaned up, ready to go, and get it laminated, and it's basically ready to install when we're ready. So we need to put this bearing block in and the other one in place, and then we can drop our intermediate shaft in here. It won't be in the bearings, it'll just be loose in here. We can roll it back and forth from side to side, and then we can start putting the covers down. If we do it that way, we'll be able to drop those in through the fish hold now. If we don't, we'll have to take the rudder off and pass them through the back of the boat, and that's just another big process to go in there and drop that rudder off, and it's something that we'd like to avoid if possible.
Yeah.
Because there's really no need to do it. So our thought is that we can just do one panel at a time. So we'll basically come in here. These panels are 40 inches long. That's them right here. So we just glue in this first one and the second one and put a panel down. It'll come to right here, and then can slide underneath here, tab out this first one, gel coat it, and then just work our way back. The shaft can lay in here and it won't be in the way too much. Do one side, squirm out, roll it over, do the other side type thing. Shouldn't be too bad. We're probably gonna tape all this off to about right here and just gel coat this while it's all completely open. It'll give us a nice smooth finish in there. So yeah, I'm hoping that we can get this last one in right here and I can slide in to do the work. But if not, Matt's got long arms and he'll just have to just feel around in the dark, I guess.
Yeah, I'm thinking we could do a half panel here too. It's an option because the seam will just be overlapped by the support here.
Yeah.
So we could do that first full panel and then just do a half panel there, and then you'd be able to reach that fairly easily.
I think that that's actually a good idea because right here is going to be our hatch and we want that to be a full piece and not have a seam where the cutout is. So if we did, this is one panel, this is a half panel here, and then we could do a full panel again where the hatch is, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we're gonna have to basically do the same thing in the back too, because a person just won't be able to, you have to get out somewhere.
Yep.
So at some point you're gonna be reaching through the hatch and finishing up. So yeah, that makes sense like that. Half panel in here. And this will be two layers too, by the way. So there's gonna be plenty of strength in here. It's gonna be two layers like that on top of this. So by the time this is all glassed over, this is gonna be a pretty rigid structure.
Yeah. Yep, work in progress, but it's come along.
Yeah, getting a lot of this little stuff out of the way that has to be done in order to move on. Okay, so our bearing block goes in about there. Roughly. I guess I still need to get that angle too. Tip back a little bit, something about like that. And let's see, put this dirty bearing on top of here. Something about like that. My patented finger measuring system.
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty, well, there it is. That looks pretty good. So we'll have a couple of cross pieces here. It looks like they'll get trimmed a bit. That's gonna add some strength. Probably just double up around this whole bottom. Second.
A ring.
Yeah, a ring. And it doesn't need to extend out past this, just a hair for that one, just so it registers a little bit on it. And that'll help transfer all the force into the sides again. And with the stagger joint up here, same thing. So that should work out real good. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that's good.
Is that about right?
Mm-hmm.
Should be able to kind of... Oh yeah, you can see in there quite easily, actually.
Not quite as, I guess, obstructed as I thought it'd be looking up that way.
Yeah, so that'll work good. So this is essentially what our inspection hatches will look like. And this will allow us to get in here, inspect this bearing occasionally, make sure that there's no issues with it. You can take the cap off it, take a look at it. See how the wear surface is, if everything looks fine. Same thing in the back, we'll have two back there, one for the bearing and the coupling forward, and then one in the very back, just a smaller one to be able to access the stuffing box, maintain it, tighten up the bolts, repack it, whatever it needs. And that'll give us plenty of room here. It's actually a lot roomier back there as far as clearance, because the bearing block gets quite a bit lower back there, and the stringers are stepped up an inch and a half, well, 2 inches. So there's a little more clearance back there, a little more height of the shaft alley. This first layer will have a ring underneath it to help support the hatch. So what we're gonna do is we'll just incorporate this into these cross pieces. There'll be one right here, and there'll be one right here. So I'm gonna go ahead and I'll do the same thing over here. I'll put an angle, and then I'm just gonna cut this straight across, and then we'll just have a plate that drops right in there with the hole cut in it. It'll be, oh, probably a half inch, maybe 3/4 inch in from our first layer of the hatch cover itself. That'll provide some support for it to register and disperse that load. And the nice thing about that is then that first layer will just be able to drop down there and get glued in. We won't have to, this whole piece underneath can all be tabbed in beforehand, and it'll make that work a lot simpler. That cross brace, if that's in there, it's all tabbed in, and then we're just dropping panels down on top and gluing them to that. Life will be very simple.
Hello.
Hi, baby.
Special delivery.
Hey.
There you go.
Hi. Good God. You would bungle that into the hole, too.
How's all our friends?
Good.
How's my guys?
Good.
Oh, don't worry. I took your bacon bit down.
You want to show everyone your lunch? We told them they could join us one of these days.
Probably not today. Too hot out. All right, so I was just getting ready to cover this bearing block here. Dad rounded out the edges, smoothed it out nicely. And then I cut some glass for it. Just gonna use 45 because it tends to wrap around corners easier than 90 does. So we'll give her a go here. Thank you.